So I'm going to try and follow his script.
Yep.
Greet you guys, make you feel comfortable, and then go from there. Let me get this sorted out, and then we will be handing out a little score sheet so that you can match the way I present to what he says. And then if I didn't do it, you guys would get a chance to take me out and flog me. do you want me to stand on this side? Or that
no,
side?
No, it's fine.
That side? Okay. So my name is Naresh Parshotam. I'm a Singaporean, and I've lived my last 30 years in the States. I've done seven startups there, and now one here. And I have the good fortune of knowing Chuck. Found out not too many years ago, I guess, when I got married, that he's actually my cousin. And we didn't find out until he showed up at our wedding, and he was on the list, and we had to seat him down. And my wife looked at me and said, "Hey, I didn't know you kept in touch with Chuck." My wife knows Chuck too. And I said, "Well, I thought you invited him." And turns out my father-in-law invited him because he was our cousin, and we happened to be in the same college, and we didn't know. We didn't know for 12 years until we met him. So, anyways, and we've kept in touch since, and we followed each other over years, and so whenever I come back here to visit my company that's here with my partner Joe, sitting over there, every now and again we are asked to hang out. Sometimes he says, "Come and talk about something." So he suggested that perhaps I should try sharing my perspective of what it's like to have companies in the States and start companies there, and what it is like over here. So I will jump in and tell you, first of all, what do we do? I have a company called Change with Joe, and I'm the co-founder, I'm the CEO, and we do something very, very simple. We have a marketplace for cross-border payments that ensures compliance and essentially make sure that the money is remitted fast and safe. And that's our business. Think of it as a dating app, perhaps, but instead of dating to meet people, you're getting Max to exchange money at a remitter level, right? And you have to be licensed, etc. So that's sort of what we do. And in a nutshell, if you look at all these guys, none of these guys, they all provide platforms, and none of them actually own the content, the taxi, or the media, or the actual goods, or the services, etc., right? They don't own any of it, but they provide a marketplace for that to work. And essentially, that's what we're doing. We're providing a marketplace. We have no intent of owning any currency, but we'll enable the currency remitters. That's who we are. Shameless plug for my company. So instead of talking you through, you know, what's it like to start a company there, and then what's it like to start a company here, I thought I'd try something a little bit different. The proverbial SWOT analysis, and kind of show you the strengths and things like that. So we'll start with the strengths, right? What's good about starting a company in Singapore that sort of fairly well matches perhaps what happens in the States, right? You have an excellent infrastructure now. If you asked me this question 5 years ago and 8 years ago, there was no way I would even dream about trying it. Well, I used to dream about starting something here, but I would never have done it. But today, the infrastructure is excellent. The ability to get on the net, the ability to get to the cloud, to start a company and roll up a physical or virtual company is really, really easy. And the best part, I think, about being here is the funding, right? There's so many funding sources that you can get, right? You start off with your government grants. Nothing like that exists in the States. And if it does, it's really, really difficult. The gyrations that you have to go through to get to that grant is very high. The bar is really, really high. It's difficult to do that. And then, of course, you know, we all have the three F's, right? The friends, family, and fools. Here and there, they're everywhere, so you have that as well. And I think a big distinction is the number of high net worth individuals over here who are looking to diversify their portfolio, the amount of those guys is a lot higher. My understanding is we have 16, maybe 17 billionaires in this country. That's a ton of money that's available for startup investment. And you know, and lastly, the VCs over here as well, right? So it's fairly equivalent. I think the biggest differentiator is the access to the grant and how easily, in double quotes, you can get to it, relatively speaking, compared to the States. That's the big thing, right? The challenge that we have in Singapore comes in a few forms, right? One is experience. So we're young, and we're just starting to get into this. We've been doing technopreneurship, entrepreneurship for about 10 or 11 years. In 2001, wrote a white paper for the Economic Review Committee for the government on education and entrepreneurship and how we should move forward. I think some of the things are now getting implemented 11, 14, 15 years after the fact. So it's taken a while to get to this stage. So the challenge is experience. Right? If you don't implement this kind of a system, how do you get people to gain experience, right? You've got to kind of do it, and then you get the experience. You fail, you fall, you start over, you keep going at it, right? And that comes to the second thing, the risk DNA. I think in our schools, we don't teach enough risk DNA. And I think the government doesn't help us, the education doesn't help us understand that it's okay for you to take a risk and fail, because you can pick yourself up again and keep doing it, right? That's not in our DNA. So unless you're already wired to be an entrepreneur and not afraid of failure, it's kind of tough. And that's a big challenge buried across over. And our culture doesn't help us, right? Asians by nature, you know, oh, I'll lose my face if I, you know, lose my rice bowl and I can't pay my friend back or whatever. And we're always worried about that piece of it, and it becomes difficult. And to be fair, I am too, right? As an Asian entrepreneur, I'm always afraid to go after the three F's. I try to go for the fools more than the friends. But it's harder for me as well, because I don't want to fail, because I feel an extreme responsibility that if I lose my friends' money and my family's money, you know, I lose face. And so it's there's a tight balance. But at the same time, if you don't take the risk, then how do you, you know, get out and get things done, right? The other thing is the Me Too ideas, right? There's so many people, because it's so easy to start a company, everybody has an idea and everybody tries to latch on to a Me Too idea, which is okay in and of itself, because a Me Too idea and an idea that starts up in the States could be reapplied and reconfigured to focus on the things that are important over here, the different cultures, our cultural nuances, the way we do business, the way we consume is different. So you could potentially do that. But the challenge is, if you're going to have a Me Too idea, you better figure out that the market is broader than what you have here. And there's too many of those here that try to do that. And everybody's then looking for the model answer, which is the same back to your Me Too idea. Like, hey, they did it over there. Let me remodel that and make it happen over here. Sometimes the model will not translate. So that's a big challenge, right? So how do we innovate, and what can we do ourselves, right, to innovate and be different and think through? And I think that goes back to the first bit of it, which is the experience. Without the experience, without failing, without understanding what's going on in our culture and our environment, it's hard for us to do all the things that we need to do. But the good news is, the reverse of some of the things that I said, the opportunity is the region, right? Our region is very diverse, and each one has a different culture. We joke about it, right, in our company, because we're doing a currency thing. Our joke is, if you get on a bus in Singapore and cross the border, it's a new currency. Whereas in the States, what we do doesn't apply, because you cross the border, it's still a US dollar, right? So that market is very different. So if you try to do remittance business over there, creating a marketplace for remittance, it won't work. But here, it's brilliant, right? And the diversity of the region and the high growth area that we're in, right, makes this an amazing opportunity to do stuff in over here. So you've got to figure out that when you come up with an idea, what you're doing, does does it apply? And if it applies over here, how do you take that idea and scale it? Because trying to just do a great idea in Singapore is not going to work, because the market is too small. But if you can come up with an idea, get it right in Singapore, and think about how you're going to scale it to the region, the market is huge. Right? Look around and see who are the new countries that are coming out today in the region that are high growth and growth. Yeah? Look at Laos, Vietnam, Myanmar, Cambodia. These are all new economies. But how do you create something that's unique for them and applies to them that can enable them to grow? Now, if we can get all of those things, I don't know if you guys ever read a book, Only the Paranoid Survive. Eddie Grove wrote this. He was the, as you guys know, former founding, departed now, of Intel, right? And he wrote this book, and his thing was, the reason why they succeeded is no matter what they did, as they invented and developed, they always were looking over their shoulder to see who was coming after them. Right, I think the story that Joe mentioned earlier was about how this company had an amazing product, but they kept getting leapfrogged by other people, right? And I think that happens when you're not aware of your threat. Who's chasing you and who's coming after you? And frankly, I think that the threat that we face here as entrepreneurs in Singapore is very regional. Because if we don't take the risk and we don't do what we have to do, and if we're just comfortable in our day-to-day jobs, then I guarantee you that the guys from Laos, Burma, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, they're all dying to either come here or to create the invention that will eat our lunch. And once they start eating our lunch, they'll eat our breakfast and dinner too. So that's a huge threat, and I think that they can, in some instances, at least from my vantage point, be hungrier than entrepreneurs, or just in general, maybe not the entrepreneurs because you're a special breed, but I think the general public is. The region, I think, is hungrier than we are. We're very comfortable, and I think that's why we have a lot of people coming in, quote unquote, eat our lunch. And I think the last is our complete reliance on a model answer. I've been here enough times, and a lot of times the questions that are asked are, if I do this, 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 and this, will I get there? And will I get to that point? What's the model answer for me to create a marketplace? What's the model answer for me to create a business service? And I think that's a very, very big challenge that we have to get ourselves out of. And I think it's a huge challenge for us because our education system drives this notion of model answers. There's no idea of collaboration, right? How do you work with people and come up with solutions as opposed to teacher, what's the answer? What's the answer? And we're always looking outside to what is the answer as opposed to trying to go figure out what the answer itself is or could be. So that's kind of the perspective that I have. I'm happy to take questions. I think I have 1 minute remaining. So, I know this is a bit short. I got given a very small amount of time and it's very focused on specific things, but I'm more than happy to either take quick questions now or after. Yes, sir?
Can I ask you about the way you think about going for funding in the AAA thing? Yeah, and being risk averse, did you have trouble approaching family or did you not bother with approaching family when it came to the initial investments?
I think I have. I have approached family and I have some family funding in the company, and so I didn't have too much trouble. But I think, like I said right in the beginning, because then again I have a track record, right? This is my 8th startup. It's not my first. I've had 7 in the States. I've had 4 exits. 3 of them, you know, for shutdown and whatever, walked away from. But so with a track record, it's a lot easier. But in the beginning, it gets to be tough because you also have to balance, you know, the family ties and the relationship that you have. So we have very little family money. We have more friend money. And we have no fool money, actually. I was hoping we had fools, but we don't. So we have good. We have really good money. Kennedy, our investors, are actually all boys from our school that we know that are successful and like what we do and have experience in the space. To take this slight tangent is what we started and what we pitched is not what we're doing now. And it's only been 10 months. So one of our investors was asked, you know, Bhagav, we came here, invested in this idea, and now they're doing something completely different. And one of his partners asked, right, our investor's response was, yeah, it's sort of normal. The reason we invested in them was the idea was good, but we invested because the guys, we knew they were going to do something. And they had to change, so it's okay, you know, just relax, you'll be fine. And I think that reason I brought that up also is because from a Me Too perspective, right, don't be too married to your idea, because sometimes you have a good idea, you might have to keep shifting and turning and shifting and turning until you arrive to the point where it sort of grows and blossoms. Or you might out of the gates have the best idea in the world and you kick it off, right? But if you look around at all the big companies and all the big ideas, they've all shifted. Netflix used to ship DVDs, and they stopped that, and they're streaming, and now they're making their own content. So it's one example, right?
So you have run startups in Silicon Valley, and now you have one in Singapore. Can you identify, I know that in Singapore we have, typically Asians are risk averse, right? But when you meet up with your, when you hire recruit the staff, what is the difference between the attitude of the staff in the US startup and the attitude of a staff in Singapore and customers as well? What are the differences in terms of attitude?
Wow, that's a big question. So let's start with the question is what is the attitude difference or perhaps the acceptance of a startup company from an employee perspective and a customer perspective?
Well, over here, right, in Singapore, everyone is crying about you cannot find staff and all that. You find staff and then, you know, soon they get a big offer from a big MNC. They say, thank you very much, I'm leaving.
Yeah.
So I wanted to know the difference, in US,
correct,
you know, do they take a ride together with you, you know, go through the up and down, you know, more of them are like that, or, you know, what is the general difference?
I think the general difference on the risk averseness is starting to sort of become, at least in the States, right, it's becoming closer than to here, perhaps to some extent. The thing is the culture of risk taking is a lot higher. The smallest businesses, the middle enterprises, small, medium enterprises are the ones that fund the economy in the States more than the MNCs. So the mom and pop shops are actually the ones that actually drive employment and business and growth. The larger companies, sadly, are taking that out and making it harder for the little guy, right, to succeed. So the risk averseness, despite that, right, is still there because people are still trying and pushing and driving, and I think it's in the DNA. So when they come to look for employment at a startup, for example, right, a lot of times it's because it's in their DNA to take that risk. It's in their DNA to do something that's smaller. And it's also because they've had it, because they can't get satisfaction in a larger company. They become a number and an insignificant thing. I've had 4 acquisitions, all into big companies, and each one after a year and a half, I left. Bailed and started another one, and then did it again and again and again. And it's just in my DNA. And a good friend of mine said to me that, dude, you're not designed for a big company, you're not designed for quality. Just go back and go start something, join a small, medium company, and you'll be happier. And so my wife was thrilled when I left my last job and started a small company. She said, no, you're not going to be that
potential customers?
So there, that's a great thing. The potential customers there, they understand because it's so imbued in the culture to take a chance with a small company that they do value them. Because at the end of the day, they are desperate to get solutions to solve the problem, right? So if there's something innovative and it's been funded and they look at the risk of this person disappearing, they measure that and they're willing to try the solution. So a lot of times what they'll do is they'll risk a small portion of their budget. My last startup that got acquired about 7-ish years ago, I think it was 6, I don't remember anyway, doesn't matter when, I was selling to Pfizer, and they loved that solution. It was supposed to be a $1.2 million deal, right? And I remember this very clearly. We negotiated it, we closed the deal, agreed, we did a POC, they loved it, it solved their problem, we gave them the reports and everything that they needed. And came down to negotiation. And the guy says, you know, I don't want the way you price it, I want it to be priced the way I price things and the way I buy things. I said, fine, what's that gonna be? And he gives me that metric, which is basically by per server. And I said, fine, okay, so for per server, it's $1.2 million. He says, fine, okay, great with that. Next week, I received a PO for $120,000. It was 10% off that budget that he had promised, right? But they're willing to take the 10% risk. The reason I didn't get the whole thing was because he viewed it as too much of a risk for a startup, but he gave us 10% of the order. Then if he had proved it out, he would have gone off and bought the rest of it. Turns out, 2 months later, we got acquired, and then he called and said, well, okay, so we can do the rest of the order now, instead of 6 months. And so that kind of stuff happens. But the thing is they do still have this risk basis on which they conduct business, and they're not worried about the, you know, if I buy from a startup and they fail, I'm going to be screwed, right? Which has happened to me over here. Singtel, when I was in my first startup in the States, the Singtel manager refused to buy our solution despite us being a Singaporean founder company. I'm all excited, wow, Singtel Singapore is going to buy my solution. They blew us off and bought a competitive solution, even though the competitive solution was worse. We beat one of the POC, but they refused to take the risk. So that thing is still here, I think. So that's going to be a challenge.
On the VC, I mean, maybe you can share with us, compare the VC here vis-a-vis the Silicon VC. From our experience, it seems like here it's not really a VC, it's more like a bank will give you some loan.
So they are venture funds here.
They call themselves venture, but I do some startup. I just, from your experiences, the quantum is normally quite small and the risk appetite does not seem to be too high too.
Yeah, I would agree that, but it's also the same. The big challenge and the big shift that has happened, right, from 10 years ago when I started my first company till now, I'm just making up a number, right? Back then, 1 in 10 would succeed because it was really, really hard to start a company, right? That you didn't have the internet infrastructure. If you're trying to build software and you're trying to host it, you had to come up with a data center. So there was this whole challenge of what you had to build. Today, pretty much anybody can sit in their office and spin up an AWS server, slide a credit card, and you're done. There's no challenge to start a company. So what's happening now is that you've gone from the 1 to 10 to 1 to 100 to 1 to 1,000. So the VC's funds now are bigger, they're trying to invest more, and they're trying to invest in the same ideas. So what happens is for them, the risk in the States at least has shifted to, if the idea is okay, sounds reasonable, interesting, solves a problem, there's a monetization strategy, I can do that, but what they look at very strongly there is the team. So they go after a team that they know that looks like they can execute and get it done. But now they've got so many, so they're basically spraying it out and taking risks on more money but in smaller chunks. hoping that one out of the 100 will succeed and can become the unicorn. And I think unicorns are like 1 in 1,000.
So what you're saying is that VC in USA and the local VC are comparable in terms of risk taking?
Very similar. I think the differences become, one, again, it goes back to the challenges here, right? The experience. And two, over here, because we are Asian, we like to get a bargain, we like to squeeze the valuations down. And the American VCs don't do that. They don't do that because they understand fundamentally, if they take away 50% of your company, you've lost incentive to work, and they've wasted their money. So there is a part, I think in Chuck's conversation last week, kind of drew up a chart of what the valuation needs to look like, right? And so what trajectory that follows. And it's a couple of candidly, it's hard to evaluate what a startup is worth from the beginning, but there are kind of rough things that you need to know, right? Over eight, I can tell you that the revenue projections for almost pretty much any company I've done has always been in the first year, a couple hundred K, second year, 2.5 million, third year, 6 million, fourth year, 16, 20 million. Right? It's pretty much every one of the enterprise software companies I've built have been like that. It's almost a no-brainer. Then what you have to do is evaluate, you know, you have to be realistic about how you're going to value yourself, and then you have to know what you're worth so that when you have a conversation with a potential investor, you're also not getting squeezed out, right? There has to be a line where you have to be able to walk away. And I think that, again, comes from experience. It's a big challenge. The first time is the hardest. It's the hardest.
Hi, so I have another question. So regarding, like, what investors are actually looking for, is there a difference in what they're looking for, you know, locally, like local investors, you know, VAs, like, investors overseas?
Yes.
Based on your experience, of course.
So what are investors looking for? Comparatively speaking, locally and over there, pretty much the same thing. Is the idea fundable? Is it, quote unquote, going to be a $1 billion idea? And is the team capable of executing? And if the team isn't capable of executing, let's say on the business side, but they're technically strong, are they open to me bringing in the business context to help the team execute? Right? And that's pretty much the same sort of criteria. How are you going to monetize your idea? And if you monetize your idea, are you going to be a $1 billion company? And for you to be a $1 billion company, let's say you say, yeah, sure, I can, right? Well, do you and your team have the pedigree to do it? Can you actually get it done? It's the same.
Chuck has a question.
Chuck has a question? The button can ask me in text, lah.
Singapore wants to be the Silicon Valley of the East. Are we getting there, or should we kind of replace the Silicon Valley model?
I don't think. Okay, so like I said, right, 5-7 years ago, if you asked me to start a company here, I would have said forget about it. Right, it's just impossible because people don't get it. But I think that the new generation of companies and the idea of Block 79 and 71. I think it's working, right? Joe and I keep talking about where are we going to open our office next, and we think this has a great vibe. This area here has a great vibe. Are we on the right path to get to that point? I think so, but I think it's still a long road. Because imagine, right, 10, 11, no, 15 years ago, we wrote that white paper. It's now sort of slowly trickling in and slowly happening. So I think it'll take another 10, 15 years to go before we get there. The other part is, should we follow the Silicon Valley model and that blueprint? Yes and no, somewhat, right? We've got to start getting out of the mold of model answers and more collaborative, free-thinking sort of education, right? That is measured not on what your test score was, but rather the journey of getting to that test score. My youngest son sees patterns, and he does math without showing the work, and he's been dinged a number of times because he sees the pattern, but he doesn't show the work. So I think what we have to get to is not the answer, but rather how did I get there, and put some emphasis on that journey because the journey of getting to a successful company or a failed company is still valuable. It's still extremely valuable, because if you trip up and fall, you'll know about the next time, don't do that, right? Whereas if you just know, oh, he's a billionaire, he did a unicorn, this guy sold his company, but he may not have learned, or if he did, what did he learn? Or if he failed, why did he fail? Is he the wrong guy to invest in because he failed? Did he fail because the idea was too early? Right? One of the startups that I did was an equivalent version of Siri, way before Siri was there. It's in 2001. Cisco acquired it and killed it. But the point is, we were too early. The infrastructure just wasn't there to do that then. But did I fail? I think so. Oh well. So I think the blueprint can't be the same. It has to be regionalized. It goes back to the opportunity, right? Because what works over there doesn't work over here. We're different from a mindset. Our culture is different. The way we speak is different. The way we eat, drink, associate with people is different. Every time I get excited and want to run and sprint to business, Joe tells me, bro, this is Singapore, relax. This is not how we do things. This is not the US. You say, relax, bam, slowly. And I have to learn that, right? So we can't adopt that model over here. We have to adjust ourselves to see what our universe looks like. We've got to stop looking outside. Come on, we're one of the fastest, best countries in the world. Why do we want to copy somebody that's going to potentially elect Trump as the president? Right? So, no, I think we have to have our own model. We can base it on it.